Hey there, lads and ladies, it is Petrifying Pumpkins here with a new Firewall Zero Hour video. This one is a continuation of a video I made 3 months ago. Now back then it was called Firewall Zero Hour 1 month later. This one is Firewall Zero Hour 4 months later, and I'll let you figure out why. And it'll be about taking a look back on how Firewall has progressed and evolved since that first video right up until today. So let's hop right into it. It is now 2019. Happy New Year, everyone, by the way. And Firewall Zero Hour still has a very active player base 4 months after launch. So suck on that, every rando on Reddit who insisted this game will be dead after a month. Now, you may think that having an active player base after only 4 months is not that big of a deal, but on PSVR, that is a fairly big deal. Quite a few PSVR multiplayer games have become ghost towns shortly after launch, but it seems like Firewall has what it takes to keep PSVR owners putting the headset back on time after time. And with the holiday season just passing us by, there has been a recent injection of fresh Firewall players taking their very first steps into the magical world of VR. But what has changed since my last video, and what does 2019 have in store for First Contact Entertainment's first PSVR title? Well, since the last video, First Contact released DLC number 1 in mid-October. Now, DLC number 1 focused primarily on integrating the PlayStation Store within Firewall, and the first cosmetic DLC items were released. This DLC set the template for what would constitute cosmetic DLC, which all subsequent DLC releases have followed. So you get the 4 weapon camos, you get the 4 contractor camos, usually the same. You get the 4 face paints, 4 trinkets, and 4 patches, with PS Plus members getting a further free cosmetic item for a limited period of time. So not only that, but the weekly Firewall Friday community updates by Damon Shabasteri began as promised. It was around the time of DLC number 1 where Shabs teased us on some of the fixes and improvements that the team were working on. This included a fix for AFK players, improvements to weapon offset, aka nipple aiming, and anti-aliasing toggles for PS4 Pro users, and smoke grenade adjustments. They also later teased a fix for the infamous suicide jammer exploit, as well as economy adjustments with crypto amounts being altered. So then in late October, patch 1.05 hit Firewall Zero Hour, and it did indeed hit some of these teased features. It brought with it an option to disable the weapon offset. This was one of those things that I didn't know I wanted until I disabled it myself, and it made a lot of people happy, so that was very well received. So those of us who played on PS4 Pros also got the ability to toggle off anti-aliasing with 1.05. However, the reception to this change was more mixed. Disabling AA on Pro may make the text easier to read, but it introduces some fairly harsh shimmering. Many were hoping for more of a middle ground rather than the all or nothing approach that First Contact have taken with AA on the PS4 Pro. This patch also made it so that the game would recall your last used contractor rather than a random one, and it also finally put an end to the suicide jammer exploit by destroying the equipment of players who commit suicide during the match, thus rendering their jammers useless. Challenges were also expanded to have 10 levels rather than the just one that they had, and are a nice way to earn some larger amounts of XP. The smoke grenade, whom many thought was more like a vape pen than a smoke grenade, was buffed to have a more dense smoke cloud, although it does dissipate fairly quickly. The crypto changes were also introduced in 1.05, so picking up a crypto on the map was now worth 50 crypto rather than the measly 20 crypto it had been. There was also some improvements made for left-handed people, but who cares about those freaks? Update 1.05 had quite a nice selection of improvements and was mostly well received, apart from some crashing that was introduced briefly but was very quickly fixed in 1.06. So then in early November, we got our first teaser trailer for DLC number 2. The teaser featured a new female contractor sitting down in front of some computer screens. The screens then changed to display 3 brand new weapons, a tease for the contractor's skill, and what I believed at the time was a tease for a new map. We were given a release date of the 20th of November, and this trailer led to a lot of speculation from the fans and myself. We figured out pretty quickly that 2 of the new weapons were based off a P90 SMG and a FAMAS auto rifle. but the skill and the map left a lot of the community guessing. In the community update that detailed this teaser trailer, we were also told that DLC number 2 would be the last DLC drop of 2018, with the rest of the team's focus being on fixes and improvements to the gameplay. Meanwhile, in the game itself, the Mesa had evolved and a new unlockable attachment had become God, the grenade launcher. Both feared and hated by those who fell victim to it and loved by those who wielded it, it had become very prevalent in the game as more people leveled up and unlocked it. The grenade launcher can attach to many of the game's auto rifles, though it does require you sacrifice your lethal throwables. It seems to deal the same damage as an impact grenade, but it can be shot while simultaneously firing your rifle, the combination of which often proves very fatal, and if used right, can end a match very quickly. The downside of using a grenade launcher is that you don't get the aiming arc you do from using a normal grenade, so in theory, it does take more skill to use it accurately. And the few times that I have used this, I've indeed almost killed myself more than the enemies, but that's with little practice. This very recent post on Reddit got 60 upvotes and sparked some heated debate, so let me know your thoughts on the grenade launcher in the comments below. Anyway, back to the DLC. The Israeli contractor Nash was revealed to the world on the 20th of November. Now, Nash is the first DLC contractor ever added to Firewall, and while she is paid DLC, her skill, Binary, which allows you to carry two C4 charges, was added to the game for all to buy with in-game currency as long as you had reached level 45. The Spitfire, G6 Commando, and XMR90 were also added to the game, the first DLC weapons to ever be added. All of these were purchasable only with in-game currency, and all three weapons were quickly adapted by the player base. P90 in particular was very impressive, so impressive that it seems it was nerfed a little shortly after it was released. DLC number 2 also brought with it a batch of new cosmetics, however, there was no map included. So despite DLC number 2 adding some great stuff, there was a bit of disappointment floating around over the fact that there wasn't a new map, even though First Contact Entertainment never promised a map, but people like me went ahead and speculated and got people's hopes up. So then, it was a very nice surprise when First Contact Entertainment announced that, despite what they said earlier, there was going to be another DLC drop in 2018, on December 18th to be precise. Although no details were given about what it might include at the time, I think we were all praying for a map. It was around this time that Firewall Zero Hour was up for a nomination for VR Game of the Year at Jeff Keighley's Game Awards show, the most prestigious game awards show on Earth. Now, unfortunately for First Contact Entertainment, it was Astrobot who took that prize, and unfortunately for all of us, the VR category was more of a quick announcement than an actual celebration like most of the other categories. So even if Firewall did win, we wouldn't have got to see them even receive the award. Hopefully, as VR grows, that kind of thing changes. But anyway, after that, new fixes were teased to arrive alongside DLC number 3, including the long-awaited AFK fix. On the 18th of December, DLC number 3 dropped, and it did indeed bring with us a brand new map, as we had all hoped. The new map, called Containment, was set in Greenland and sees us battling for control of the laptop in some high-tech laboratories and brightly lit rooms, and has been received very well by the community, especially seeing as it was released free of charge. DLC number 3 also brought another batch of cosmetics, as well as some nice fixes. Finally, AFK players were addressed, and if you are idle too long in a match, you will now get a warning message before being kicked out of the game if you continue to idle. The patch also included a change to the Taylor CQB variant, changing it from burst fire to full auto, making it more unique compared to the full-size Taylor. Finally, eye movement was added to the contractors in the lobby area, adding a bit more visual flair and believability to these avatars. There was going to be another improvement added in this patch that had to be pulled at the last minute thanks to a bug. Originally, the patch would have also included voice chat during load screens, fixing a fairly minor annoyance that currently exists in the game. However, this fix is still scheduled to arrive in early 2019. And so that brings us up to date. We've talked a lot about what has been added to Firewall, but we haven't really talked about some things that feel like they might be missing. So the number one request from the community right now is for either host migration or dedicated servers. And First Contact Entertainment haven't said too much about this since my first video. However, They did already tell us in the past that host migration is not native to Unreal Engine 4, so it would be a really big undertaking to put that into the game if they do it at all. But do keep in mind that First Contact Entertainment are very unlikely to mention anything that they can't 100% guarantee. So just because they're not talking about host migration or dedicated servers doesn't mean they aren't working on that stuff behind the scenes, waiting until their hands are no longer tied to talk about it. But that's purely speculation on my part. Another noticeable absence is that of any new game modes. First Contact Entertainment have hinted at the inclusion of a hardcore mode in the past, but we are yet to get it. Now, it could be possible that they don't want to split the player base up by adding in a new mode, but perhaps the recent influx of players, thanks to the holidays, will be enough to make a new mode viable. We will have to wait and see. In the meantime, First Contact Entertainment have reaffirmed their commitment to Firewall by telling us that there's plenty more to come in 2019, and I know I can't wait to see what they have planned. So, Firewall 4 months later is much improved over Firewall at launch. It has a healthy player base that I hope Sony recognizes, as there aren't too many PSVR games that can say that. It has a small but talented team improving it with every update, and it has a ton of potential to become even better in 2019 with further support and a growing player base. And it is still, 4 months later, the only game that gets me moist. Thanks for watching, lads and ladies. If you enjoyed this video and want to see more Firewall and PSVR content, then consider doing all that usual shite. Of course, I'd also like to hear what you think of Firewall's first 4 months. Are you happy with the direction it's going in? And what are your hopes for the game in 2019, etc., etc.? I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye for now.